Blade Runner is such a complex film with a very complex mystique. And Blade Runner is nothing if not a film about details. There's amazing material that have been lost. The interesting thing about Blade Runner is that there are no less than 5 known versions of the film.
I did a cover story for a magazine called Video Watchdog, and it was one of the very first articles that not only pointed out that there were now 2 versions out there, but there were more.
The first time I think there was ever any idea of there being a different version of Blade Runner was when it came out on home video in the early mid-80s. It was actually promoted as having additional scenes of violence not in the theatrical cut. And there was a little bit with, you know, Pris fighting Deckard and kind of pulling his nose, and Deckard shooting Pris an extra time, and then, you know, most notably, Batty crushing Tyrell's head. And that's how we knew Blade Runner for the longest time. I mean, that's kind of the version that ended up in the Criterion Laserdisc. You know, it wasn't until 1990 when the Workprint leaked out at that Fairfax 70mm Film Festival. That inspired Warners to release the Workprint theatrically in a limited run at the NuArt Theater in Los Angeles and the Castro Theater in San Francisco. And it broke house records wherever it played. It sold out every show, and they had to extend the run because so many people were clamoring to see this new lost cut of Blade Runner.
I think there was a great fuss about nothing. I mean, there was really just the accidental removal. A print was run without a voiceover, and the end ended in the elevator. That's really about it.
This was the version of Blade Runner that was essentially shown at the Denver and the Dallas sneak previews. This had a different opening, slightly different ending. Of course, the original ending with the elevator doors closing on the pair, and other bits and pieces of scenes added and subtracted.
And that encouraged Warner Brothers even more. So they said, well, let's put up the true director's cut, because Ridley had said the work print wasn't his true director's cut, which would mean no voiceover, no happy ending, but the inclusion of the unicorn dream, which, you know, suggests Deckard may be a replicant.
You know, it's apparently very important to Ridley Scott to have that in the film. Deckard as possible replicant, as, you know, he sees a unicorn that he remembers he saw in a dream, and this kind of plants questions in his mind and in the audience's minds as to whether Deckard himself, the Harrison Ford character, is a replicant as well.
The unicorn daydream that Deckard has at his piano has a long, convoluted history. There was always a supposition that that unicorn shot had been an outtake from the film that Ridley Scott did after Blade Runner, which was Legend. When the director's cut came out in 1992, a lot of film people thought, oh, he just pulled some footage that he shot for Legend and put it into Blade Runner. Not true. Not true at all. By this time in 1992, home video was so firmly established that there was a whole new audience, the home viewing audience. So a new version of a popular film could obviously generate more revenue.
Bringing us to today, where we did finally get to do Ridley's final cut that he was involved with. He was involved with, you know, over the years. So this time, that's why I came up with the phrase final cut. I thought, okay, this, we have to like say, this is it. You know, for people who are gonna be complaining and moaning that, oh, you're gonna make us buy it all over again. This is Ridley Scott's definitive version of the film Blade Runner. It's the final cut. It was early 2000 when Warner Brothers approached Ridley about putting together a Blade Runner special edition DVD.
Well, I got the call from Warner Home Video that they wanted to see about doing a definitive cut with Ridley Scott's blessing on it, and put together an editorial team and a restoration team and go through everything we can find, which in this picture, we had elements all over the world. Of course, Charlie is a big, big piece of this. Charlie came on board through Ridley, and when Warner Home Video talked to me about the project, that's when I got introduced to Charlie. And Charlie, with his background and his knowledge of the project, using him with Gillian, and then the places I could pull from our end, is kind of the beginning of what became our project today.
My agenda at the time was basically to make sure that Blade Runner was not only treated to the best picture and sound quality possible, but that Ridley would finally get to make any last tweaks and edits and cuts to the film that he wanted to make.
What we did first was we found out that Parenchio had, in his own lockup, his vault, he had a lot of elements that had never been cataloged. It was basically what I called this black hole. And they never cataloged it, and it was one of those things that they just took possession of it, put it in the, and locked it up, and that was the end of it.
Jerry Parenchio kept the assets, which basically means the film elements, the negative, for Blade Runner at a storage facility called Preferred Media in Burbank. So we got there, and there were several pallets worth of boxes of film and negative and print and dupe and 65mm, 70mm, 35. But you can't be holding original negative with your bare hands in a dusty storage facility. So we felt it would be great to take this material to a proper post facility and start going through it systematically.
At the time, we didn't have permission to pull the elements out, so we basically set up camp there. We made it like a little sterile area, nice and clean, and where we can catalog it and then leave it there. So then I put together a team of librarians to go through every can and every roll and record every key number, which was tremendously helpful, although we had to do then current time now a second pass at, because they didn't know the characters' names. So even though we cataloged it all, we didn't have 100% information.
They managed to go through all that material over the course of, I guess it was several weeks. And the one very disturbing thing we learned out of that experience was that all of the original materials of Blade Runner, all the negative, all the prints, all of this gold, had been marked for junk back in 1988.
The way the process works is somebody went through, they decided what was junk, what was not going to be junk, and then they basically gave us the paperwork that said this is to be junk. However, we never got the final junking order, so to speak, on letterhead that said please junk or destroy the following items for this account. So the material was really just sitting in limbo on pallets for about 10 years or so, 10, 11, 12 years, until the whole Blade Runner project came about just recently, and they started going through it. So it's kind of pretty lucky that the material was never junked.
The owners of the film are the Blade Runner Partnership, which is Bud Yorkin and Jerry Parenchio. And everything would have to be approved by the Blade Runner Partnership. We didn't have direct contact with them. We were working with Warner Brothers. So we were working in a little bit of a haze, but the work was good. I mean, we were definitely making progress.
We had a cut. We knew what the film was going to look like ultimately when we got done.
But then sometime in the spring, early spring of 2002, we stopped work. And it wasn't really until 2005 that we first heard some vague rumblings that something might be happening.
Well, it's funny because I got a series of calls like, you know, it looks like we might have an agreement. It looks like we might be greenlit soon. Stand by. And then finally we're up and running full steam now. So,
having thrown out the original 2002 deal and kind of restarting over in 2005, I think it was actually a very hopeful sign, and it turned out to be the case.
Yeah. It's been a long time, 5 years since we spoke to
her. Hi, Chris.
Hi, Gillian.
Hi.
Everybody who was involved with it in the beginning, Gillian, Charlie, myself, we've all been standing by for this. We've all been just waiting to do this. And then I think it took about a total of 2 to 3 weeks to get everybody in place to really go forward.
The same conversation we had in 2002, we had all over again, except it was 5 years later. Things cost more, but the state of the art was much higher than it was back then. And actually, I think it's probably for the best that we had that five-year period, because a lot of things we've now done in the final cut, we probably could not have done back in 2002. Fairly early on in the process of reworking the visual effects or tweaking or enhancing the visual effects for the film, we actually went to the guys who created the visual effects for the film. We brought in David Dreyer, Douglas Trumbull, and Richard Jurisich. We brought them to Warner Brothers, and we kind of said, hey, this is what we have in mind. What do you guys think? And, you know, it was really funny to see these guys get back together again in a room, like they're getting the band back together, and they start talking about, hey, well, what if we did this, and what if we did that, and this is how we did it, and this is why we couldn't do it, and you know, we're sitting there thinking, it was just great to be in the room with these guys because these guys are visual effects legends.
Large cutout of photographs. On the
Rob Hummel has been a colleague and a friend for years, and he used to work at Technicolor, and he happened to be working on this film back then. And I said, we can't find the original negative from those for those effects shots. And he said, well, I think I know where it may be. So he looked back and he found him at CFI.
Did you look at, physically look at it?
I opened up cans.
So it's a lot of positives.
They're negatives.
A lot of negatives.
A lot of test shot wedges. I mean, it's everything.
Yeah.
And all neatly wrapped together and labeled with Jack Ingles on legal paper. Inside each can is Jack Ingles' handwriting, documenting everything that's in each box.
The lab sheets.
We even found lab sheets from Technicolor with my name, with my handwriting, which is like, woo.
For weeks and months, we were so focused on the new cut, and we were so focused on the sound mix, we were so focused on finding all these lost elements. The visual effects side of this restoration project was kind of, in limbo. And then Kurt brought in John Sheely to be the visual effects supervisor on Blade Runner Final Cut.
Well, the hardest thing to come to grips with in starting for me was that the goal was to perfect certain shots, to bring them to a higher level, to clean them up and touch them up, but to do as little changing as possible. That was an unusual assignment.
For Blade Runner, it was very important to me that we threw our mindset back to 1982 and really look at it from a purist standpoint. It should be more about restoration, not revisionism. And I put together a list to show Ridley of all the known and unknown continuity problems and visual effects issues and all the possible tweaks and polishes that he may or may not want to do. And I presented him this list, and he went down the list and said, yes, no, yes, no. And, some of the times he would roll his eyes, like, you got to be kidding me. We're gonna touch that. And that was when I kind of started thinking, well, there is a charm, actually, to the flaws of Blade Runner. And I think these flaws actually, strangely, give Blade Runner its life.
In Blade Runner, there are a number of shots that have flaws and problems that are built into them that the fans and lovers of the film come to call beloved mistakes. That was a strange concept to hear about, but I could understand that as you got into it.
So in going through this Final Cut restoration and going, shot by shot, scene by scene, erasing these flaws, I was always very conscious of, well, have we gone too far? And, as the bigger flaws were erased and taken out of the Final Cut, the more, medium-sized flaws started appearing. And that's when we kind of had to draw a line in the sand and we had to say, okay, that is not a flaw we're going to touch. That's a beloved flaw. And there was always some good-natured debate over what that was.
I think I'd be working in a place like this if I could afford a real snake.
The major changes, such as Zora or the baddie's dub at the end, I felt, we handled with a deep respect for the film. So in the case of Zora, most of the shot is the original shot. It's really just the real estate around Zora's head that's been altered. And we were fortunate enough to have Joanna Cassidy come back as something that she wanted to do and recreate those four or five shots that unfortunately was a very obvious stunt double. And for Blade Runner, we were very careful to make sure it was all interlaced and ingrained with the fabric of the film as it originally was in 1982, and that it not change the character or the story or the atmosphere or the themes or any of that. I mean, we were very specific about how we changed things and what we changed and why we changed them, most importantly.
The technique is first to take the original photography in which Joanna Cassidy's head was pitching around and moving and going through all contortions, and look to stabilize it down and take out movement so that finally you end up with a frame of her head that's just displacing and moving only as little as you need to see it do within the frame. Now, on the stage, Rich Hoover was directing Joanna to move in parallel to that performance that we were playing back from the earlier day, and to move her head and to match her expression and her contortions to match what the stunt woman was doing back in the original filming.
Ready, and one. Back to one, faster now.
One, and two, and three, and four, and five, and cut. That was awesome.
Rap song Blade Runner once again 25 years later.
Now, the matching in the end was maybe 80%, 90% at best. It was very close, but not perfect. Now the CG tracking tools, the visual effects tools take over, and we could slightly rotate and move and slightly change the speed warp and speed change the footage so that her movement of her head might fit a little bit better if the dynamic of the photography, the speed of the photography in the original was slightly different. So it was these kinds of tools to allow us to bring her performance back into the photography from the original film that was startling. At various points, we just would sit back and look at it and be pretty amazed to see how we'd brought her back into the scene.
How are you doing, honey?
Good to see
you. How are
you?
Good to see you.
Good to
know. Is it freezing? Is this to keep everybody awake?
Yes.
The first step in the effects process was to actually remove the head of the stunt person.
Mm-hmm.
Then I added your head.
That we felt something was missing in these versions.
Oh my gosh.
And we've also removed
the headless replicas.
We've removed the reflections between the camera and the head.
That is very disturbing.
Night of the Living Dead.
Wow.
And then, in terms of the process, then we add the green screen footage of your head.
And still here, a little rough, but starting
to. Oh my gosh. Wow.
So, here are the final shots. You know, the proof is in the pudding. I think the final product is kind of what we all were hoping it would be.
Well, and this
man worked so hard to make it happen.
He made it happen.
Well, I'm just glad, because when we talked about it the first time, it seemed like a pipe dream. Like,
well,
we'll bring you back down, we'll do the green screen, and then, like, the day before, panicked phone calls, like, oh my God, it's actually going to happen.
I think you reshoot it.
I mentioned that to Warner Brothers, and they're like,
reshoot it.
I think we should reshoot it. I think it'd be great.
I can do it.
I know you can do it.
I can do that. I have to reshoot it.
Okay.
You must tell them to do that and do it right.
Yeah.
I'm almost speechless, which rarely happens, but just the idea that it works. I mean, even to the scream right before you actually see the bullet go through and like burst.
One of Blade Runner's most infamous continuity problems is when Deckard visits Abdul Ben Hassan, the Egyptian snake dealer, and his lips are completely out of sync with the dialogue.
By work? Not too many could afford such a quality.
How many?
Very few.
How few? Look, my friend.
Duffy Lewis's, down in first sector, Chinatown.
We went through all of the ADR, we went through all of the looping, all of the sound that was recorded after the fact with Harrison Ford and the voice actor who was filling in for Abdul Ben Hassan. And none of those matched either.
We first thought, frankly, of just a stunt extra or a performer that could give us, that was a lookalike for Harrison, fairly close.
And then we kind of started thinking about, well, we're replacing Joanna's head on Zora, can we, you know, maybe, I guess Harrison Ford's too busy. And I thought, well, I know he's got sons, right? He's got a couple sons. I believe I've read that somewhere. And we're in the middle of this meeting at Sony, and David Sanger from New Deal Studios suddenly says, well, I know Ben Ford. I went to school with him. You know, Ben owns a restaurant right down the street. And literally that moment, we all got up and walked to Ford's filling station and asked for Ben, and you know, didn't get him directly, but we left a note for him to say, hey, we're working on Blade Runner, would you consider coming back and replacing your father's mouth in this scene?
I think it was smart that they sent a friendly face down to say to ask me about it. You know, that was, that made it a whole lot easier. I really didn't know what I was getting myself into today. I'm glad to see it's nothing more than I thought. Happy to do it.
Ben's a humble and great person. He doesn't overact when he performs his dad, but he can do his dad pretty well.
Somehow I've got to emulate something that has been done years ago, I guess, and you're gonna transfer it, make it work, make it a little more smooth than it used to be. One notch better.
Now, as it turns out, that year, as we're filming, he's 40 years old, young Ben. Harrison was 40 years old when he made the movie. He was at the same point in time that his dad was then.
Probably one of the ultimate geek out moments on this shoot was seeing Harrison Ford's trademark scar applied to Ben. Just that level of detail, I thought, was just so much fun to see. Ben, you know, he gets out there, he sits in the chair once again, just like Joanna did, and, you know, he has to, again, hit these marks. He has to look all over the frame to match what his dad did 25 years ago. You know, he read the dialogue off these big cue cards, and when we saw Ben's face transpose over his dad's face and shown it like a 50-50 exposure, we knew it was like, wow, this could really, really work. I mean, the lineup was excellent.
Abdul Hassan? I'm a police officer. I'd like to ask you a few questions. Artificial Snake License XB-71, that's you? Artificial Snake License XB-71, that's you?
And he did a great job. He, again, it was like a haunting moment to see his face on screen next to his dad's. It was really spooky and strange.
Sir, I'd like to ask you a few questions. Artificial Snake License XB-71, that's you? This is your work, huh? Who did you sell it to?
My work?
We were only looking at correcting a few scenes that had flaws in it, particularly where Batty releases a dove, where it just had not been realized as an effect, even when the film was being created by Ridley. He didn't have an opportunity to finish that scene.
I mean, this to me was a fast, this is on the side of the Star Wars stage.
Yeah.
This is a fast solution, because that's all I could do. That's all they let me do, actually.
In the original cuts of the film, you go from a very gritty, rainy, dark LA 2019, and then when Batty dies, he lets go of the dove, and the dove takes off, and it cuts to clear blue sky, and it just did not cut. Obviously, that was a huge shot that we were going to tackle, and have David Dreyer come in and kind of personally shepherd that with Illusion Arts was really wonderful.
The first bit of business that I would recommend is we rotoscope the real dove, we build a CG dove, and we animate it to the motion of the real dove.
In 2002, when we first started talking about how to do the dove shot, I drew a little doodle as to what I thought it should look like. And, you know, I kind of carried that all these years. And then when we first started working on Blade Runner in 2006, I remember I was on vacation and I was thinking, okay, how do we do this dove shot? And I was seeing these beautiful clouds in the sky, and I started taking digital photos, and I started putting them into my laptop, and in Photoshop I started like cobbling together what I thought it could be like, you know, sort of tonally.
Well, I think Charlie, so then I did this on my computer just really quickly as a rough, as kind of a, oh, that's a good, yeah.
The shot is not about technology, it's not about future architecture, it's about that dove getting up to the sky, because that's dove represents Batty's soul going to heaven.
Yeah, you know, I mean, you can add to the top of it and add something up there, or add some exhaust. Actually, what I'll do is I'm going to use this wedge,
mm-hmm.
and I'll keep this bit of retro,
yes.
and then I'll start fitting windows in, which are two steps up from being slummy.
Even there, what we looked at was what's become ingrained and embedded in people's mind memory of the film, is that when we recreated that scene, we looked to very carefully match the angle of the building, and so the shot would subconsciously remind you of the take that was in the original film.
You know, Illusion Arts came in with some really compelling sketches. I presented those to Ridley. Ridley kind of went through the various looks they presented, and he picked the one he liked. So the one that's in the film is actually the one that Ridley liked out of all the different concepts.
I wonder if this shot gets applause, though, like the first screening where like a lot of fans at, you know, because it's always one of those shots that people kind of groan, like, oh, it's too bad they didn't get that. And
or
it's like it's been...
Could get booed.
Could get booed.
Daphne Lewis.
Oh, I can't stand it.
The problems we had with sound was that we had no sound. there was no sound. We looked high and low on multiple continents and countries looking for the original audio elements to Blade Runner, the original stems, the original production tracks, I mean, anything.
We found on record and physically that we had like 6 tracks and 4 tracks and 2 tracks and whatnot. We were looking at them and found, yes, we have a complete set of reels. What we didn't know then is in those reels there were pieces missing and pieces that didn't sound very good anymore. That came later. But first we wanted to see if we had all the parts and pieces.
To another end of that, you know, there was also the new shots that appear in the final cut. There were some of the new, you know, some of the gaps that are generated by the changes we've made and taking out the voiceover. You know, all of these needed a little bit of help. And I think there was no one better for the team than Per Hallberg and Karen Baker Landers to spearhead the mix and the sound reconstruction and basically all the new sound effects that had to go in to fill in these blanks.
We're very fortunate that Per and his team, Karen and the rest of them, they were available, and the challenge that they had was we had 6 tracks and 4 tracks and some 2 tracks, like I mentioned earlier, that didn't necessarily cover the entire film. And also, the audio was blown out. Some tracks are going bad. One reel had a chunk missing. Nobody to this day knows why or where it went. And what they did was they were able to, from all the versions of the film that was out there, it was the director's cut, there was the international cut, there was the domestic cut, and they pieced tracks from everything to create this cut. And between that and some Foley that they did, and some sweetening of the tracks, they brought that to the dub stage, and then our mixers were just incredible at what they've been able to pull out of this track.
Ladies and gentlemen, Kathy Lewis presents Miss Hillary and the Snake.
Where I've seen efforts like this done before, and it didn't quite do the film's justice. Somehow, this team, that's an area that really, really, I applaud all of them. They did a great job.
Blade Runner is my favorite film. And to be able to go through all of these takes and lost scenes and visual effects tests and screen tests, and I mean, it was surreal. I do feel like I cherish Ridley's sensibilities, and I, you know, will fiercely defend those sensibilities, even if they're not my own. I will make sure that he gets his way. I mean, he's just an incredible filmmaker, and because of that, I know the final result is going to be great.